Morning, guys. Another major fear we have to control, master, or overcome is the fear of ill health. And this one is a challenging one each and every day for us because there are so many things that can happen. There are so many illnesses, things that happen to us that we don't expect. And we have to overcome this fear because we don't realize it, but our mind, our thoughts, that energy will affect the physical aspect of ourselves in every process the body has. So one thing that's helped me, I hope it helps you, is the idea that of Napoleon Hill, who said simply, if you think you're sick, you are sick. Over time, your body, your brain will get your body to produce those physical manifestations. So you got to think of yourself in a way where you're not afraid to get sick. You are healthy, you're happy, you are free, and it will help to also heal your body. Have a great day, everyone.
You want to solve a complicated problem, maybe you try to solve it 100 ways, and then you take the best solution.
Got it.
When do you quit?
Organize your brain when you sleep, at least to the degree that you can organize it. And you can often be more solid or more doubtful about a decision if you sleep on it.
Rise and shine, it's espresso time. Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and I am not a morning person, I'm not. But when you start your day off.
Have you ever thought of spending more time with your family without sacrificing work?
With a powerful routine that inspires you, like watch one of these videos, it will change your life. So let's start your day off right together. Grab your coffee, know that I believe in you, and get ready for a shot of espresso from Jordan Peterson.
I wake up every morning.
Espresso, keep me going.
I wake up every morning.
You know, if you really want to solve a complicated problem, maybe you try to solve it 100 ways, and then you take the best solution.
Got it.
And look, this happens to entrepreneurs all the time too, you know, like most entrepreneurs, this is something to know, well, most entrepreneurs, most creative people fail at producing their creative product and monetizing it, right? So your default position, if you're a creative person, is you're going to fail. And so, and that's because it's hard to come up with something new, and it's hard to present it to the market at the right time, and it's hard to market it. Like, those things are really, really difficult. And so what successful entrepreneurs do is they just keep doing it over and over and over and over and over and over and over. And eventually, if they're fortunate, one of their ideas happens to hit the right place at the right time. And so that's also Darwinian in some sense. You know, you're creating all these little enterprises that are sort of alive. They're run by people after all. And even if your idea is good, that doesn't mean it will be successful. There's so many things that have to be taken into account. So this is partly why persistence, and that's part of conscientiousness, is so useful. It's like, you know, what do they say? If at first you fail, then try again. And that would probably mean try something different rather than the same thing. But persistence is helpful because it enables you to run many, many experiments. And you need to know that the baseline is failure. You know, it's important because otherwise you'll blame that on yourself.
When do you quit? You quit when you don't love it anymore. You quit when the process isn't fun for you anymore. You quit when the thing you're doing starts to feel like a job. But if you still love it, you have to keep going. You have to find another way. You have to show up again today, because if you don't, you will spend the rest of your life regretting, wondering what could have happened if you just didn't quit today. The worst day of my life was when I was 20 and I quit on my business partner. I told him I quit. I can't do this anymore. I need to find something that makes me feel valuable as a human. Of all the things that happened to me in my life, you know, this has been a lot of negative situations that we've all faced, but, you know, from breaking my neck and struggling a lot, you know, the thing that just, the worst day of my life was when I told my business partner that I quit. because it's a self-identity thing. I couldn't believe that I had said those words on something I cared about. It's not about something that you weren't trying, like, oh, I'll quit on this one thing that I never really cared about anyway. We don't care about that. It's when you care about it, when you've been putting everything you've got into it and you're still not getting results and you quit for that reason. That stuff, that will eat you up. And so it was the worst day of my life because I couldn't imagine me saying it. And I was so lost and so insecure and so unsure of just what to do next. But I know that I knew that I wanted to feel valuable as a human again. And so I couldn't keep going this way. But I woke up the next day and I realized I can't quit. I can't quit now. I haven't given it everything. I don't want to be an old man at 40. You know, I'm 41 now. I don't want to be an old man at 40 and look back on my life and regret it and just know that I had a chance to do something special and I quit a little bit too soon. So if you still love the thing that you're doing, you can't quit. Not yet. So how do you still get the momentum? How do you still get the motivation? How do you still keep going? I got three tips for you that I think will help. Number one is find a different way to stand. So this was something that really saved me that came from Oprah Winfrey. She said, I don't remember the exact quote now, but something about finding a different way to stand. You have to find a different way to stand. And it just really stuck with me to say, okay, what I'm doing may not be working yet, but still will have value. It's really hard to have that belief that everything I've done to this point may not have worked, but if I keep going, will have value. I just need to find a different way to stand. I just need to find a different way of doing it. I just need to find another path. There's another way around it that I just haven't seen yet. And the path for me was modeling success. That's the thing that saved me. So I said, okay, I feel like I've done everything. I feel like I've tried every route and I'm hopeless and helpless and have no path forward. But seeing Oprah's quote, find a different way to stand, just gave me the hope and resourcefulness to say, okay, I'm going to find another way to do it. So if you still love doing it and it just hasn't worked out yet, step number one is find a different way to stand. Step number two is find someone who's done it to model success. I think one of the biggest challenges we face as entrepreneurs is we feel like we have to come up with all the ideas ourselves. You got to come up with every genius idea yourself. That's certainly what I felt, at least when I started my first business, that I had to come up with all the ideas. That was almost cheating to look what other people were doing. But no, it's not. You need to model success. You need to find the people who've done in any area of your life, in your business, in your relationships, in your health. Find the person who's done the thing that you're trying to do and then go study them. Go model them, go look at what worked for them and how you can then maybe apply that to your situation. And it won't take you 100% of the way, but it takes you 80% of the way. Every time I've learned a strategy from somebody, whether it's Jordan Peterson or Oprah or Bill Gates or Warren Buffett or whoever, I've learned the strategy from them and I apply it exactly to my life, it doesn't work out because it's not the exact same situation and they're not me, but it takes me 80% of the way. I then just have to make some tweaks and some adjustments to make it work for me. And that always speeds up my path. And it's what I've been doing ever since, what I've been teaching ever since. The fastest way to shortcut your path to success is to model somebody who's already done it. Look back at how they got started and how did they overcome those initial barriers? And then how can you apply that to your life? So for me, it was looking at Bill Gates, how he started Microsoft. He had a software company, I had a software company, looked at his success, modeled it, and suddenly I started to have some results, finally. That first check that came in for $13,500, man, that felt good. Not that it was, I mean, it doesn't seem like a lot of money, I guess now, but to me back then, that was everything. And more important, it gave some kind of hope, some kind of motivation, just some kind of traction, momentum, something was finally working. After all the things that I tried that didn't work, something finally was paying off. And so modeling success is gonna be your fastest way to get there. And then step number three is just to change up your environment. When you are around the people who are doing the thing that you wanna do, it just gives you more hope that it's possible. It gives you more belief that it can work. If you're around people who just gave up on their dreams, who are taking a safe path out, taking a safe route, telling you to go do something else, you know, go become a XYZ because that's what they became. if that's all you're around, people who are telling you that you can't do it and telling you that your ideas suck, it really becomes difficult to stay motivated, to stay on it. It takes an incredible level of self-commitment to make that happen. And it's totally possible, but what's even better is to be around the people who are doing it. So on your down days, they pull you up. And that could be having a mentor or coach. That could be hanging out with people who are, you know, in your life, who are making you believe in yourself. That could be joining a group like my Movement Makers program, where you're around people who are all doing something, trying something, building a movement, encouraging each other, who lift each other up when they're feeling down and feel like hope's not possible. Or it could just be through videos and books and podcasts and the things that you do in your daily habits and routines. Look at everything that you're doing in your routine. Look at the people that you're hanging out with. Look at the information that you're feeding into your brain. And how much of it, when you leave it, you feel better about yourself? How many videos are you watching that when you stop it, when you leave the video's over, you feel better about yourself? You feel more confident, more hopeful, more belief, more momentum. How many people that when you leave their presence, when you stop talking to them, right, you say goodbye, you feel more positive, more inspired, more ready to go home and go after your goals versus the things that make you feel like it's not gonna happen, it's not possible, you feel negative, you've lost energy compared to when you went in. And the more you can flip that to be more around the people, the resources, the energy that fill you up, even if it's just virtually, maybe you have nobody in your life. But Evan, I have nobody in my life like that. Okay, not yet, first of all, right? You have nobody in your life yet that's like that. But you still have me, you still have these videos, you still have other channels and other podcasts you can go and subscribe to and listen to that if you're around consistently, will shift you forward, will pull you forward, will give you more momentum, will give you that extra little bit of encouragement and commitment for when you feel like quitting, when you feel like the world's against you, when you feel like it's just not happening, not yet, not now, not for you, that they lift you up, that they give you that extra little oomph to go one more day, one more day, one more day. And then soon enough, that one day, something happens. And you look back and you realize, man, am I ever grateful that I kept going? If you still love what you're doing, if you still love the process, you love the work, it doesn't feel like a job showing up, you have to keep going. You have to, you have to, you have to, you have to. Because otherwise you're gonna regret it. And I don't want that for you. I don't want you to be an old man or old woman and look back and say, back here, back at this moment, right now, present day, I could have done something. I could have played bigger. I could have kept going. I could have made my mark and could have made my impact. You could have been a contender, but you didn't because you were afraid and you quit maybe one day too soon. Now I've got some special bonus clips that I think you're gonna enjoy. But before that, it's time for the question of the day. I wanna know, what was your single biggest takeaway from this video and your plan of action for the next week? When you just watch a video and get motivated, you have a 35% chance of actually doing something, making a change. That's what the science says. 35%, that's not enough, Believe Nation. But when you watch a video, you get motivated, and then you create a specific plan of action for what you're going to do, it jumps to 91% chance of you following through. And when you commit publicly, like put it in the comments below what your plan is, it jumps to 95%. So, Believe Nation, your single biggest takeaway from this video and your plan of action for the next week, put it down in the comments below so I can celebrate with you. Also, if you want to have more self-love and self-confidence, I've designed a special free training to help you get it. The science says it can take up to 254 days of consecutive action to build a habit. And if you want to build a habit of self-confidence and self-belief, check it out in the description below. There's a link that will send you a video every day for the next 254 days, 100% free, to shift your confidence forward. The link to join is in the description below.
If you're going to speak effectively, you have to know way more than you're talking about. Well, you have to treat yourself like you matter. Because if you don't, then you don't take care of yourself and you become vengeful. Oh no, you're okay. You should feel good about yourself. Like, you're fine the way you are. It's like you think, well, that's a calming message for people.
You have to negotiate until you come to the best solution that can be negotiated, which isn't necessarily a perfect solution, but it might be the best one that can be done. And then you have to stick with it until the next negotiation. And if you get upset during the negotiations, which you likely will, because these are difficult topics, how to divide up responsibilities in the house, and people get mad because they feel they've been taken advantage of or aren't being listened to. One of the rules was, well, you can leave the discussion, but only until you calm down, and then you have to come back, because these things have to be pushed through. They have to be negotiated through, because the alternative is, well, important things don't get done, or people do them resentfully because they're sort of forced by their own orderliness or their own conscientiousness, or but we know, by force, psychological or otherwise, on the part of other people. These things have to be negotiated through. You can tell if you've got the balance between making peace and speaking the truth right if the conversation continues. And it can be emotional, and will be, and can be difficult, because important things have to be dealt with. But as long as the people are still in the conversation and communicating, then you've got the balance right. You know, and you might have to take a break. Maybe you have to hold off till the next day. Maybe sometimes when you're negotiating something that's difficult, you have to offer the other person the opportunity to sleep on their decision too, which I think is often a very good idea. If you have to make an important decision in your life, it's very useful to tell the person that you're negotiating with that, look, I'm interested in this and it seems good, but I'm not going to agree until I sleep on it. Gives you, well, lots of things happen when you sleep. You organize your brain when you sleep, at least to the degree that you can organize it. And you can often be more solid or more doubtful about a decision.
Make it schedule.
Tal vez sucederá. Que toda la tristeza algún día pasará.
Take control of your mind and your thoughts and focus on your breathing. Feel the power of you, the real you, controlling your breathing. The real you is always present right now. You are more powerful than you can ever begin to imagine, because you get to focus on the greatest gift ever, now, your presence, where your attention is being drawn to now, no matter what's going on outside your mind. Feel the power of your breathing. There are astronomical numbers of things going on in one breath. That's how powerful you are. That's how powerful your determination is. So let's use that power. Let's use that third eye, that mind's eye that we all have. Let's use it right now. Let's see ourselves doing the best we can on all the stretches and exercises today in our gym period. Gym. G-Y-M. Grow your mind. And here we are in the gym of life. Growing our minds and growing our bodies. Taking control of what we truly are. Simply being. Human being, the most powerful energy thing in the universe. That's who you really are. So see yourself right now. See it in your mind. Because whatever you see in your mind, you can make real with your eyes open. Everything created with your eyes closed can be made real. With your eyes open. Good morning, Determination. Good to see everyone again. Here we are once again, working together on our minds and our bodies. When I say go, we're going to start jogging for a minute on the spot, or you can simply keep doing your best walk. It's up to you, but whatever you do, remember, do it to the best of your ability. Do it the way you were born to do it, because the way you do one thing, the way you think one thing, is the way you'll do and think about everything. All right, here we go. Ready? And go! Feel the power of you right now. Growing your mind, growing your body by simply doing your best. Your best jog on the spot. Or if you're walking, your best walk ever. Power and energy of our blood beginning to flow through different parts of our incredible bodies. Keep going, keep going. Be Use your determination. Use your greatest power. Almost there. Keep going. And stop. All right, back to our best walk. If you aren't already doing your best walk, but again, feel the power of you regaining control of your breathing, focusing your attention on your breathing. Your breath can always bring you to your greatest gift. But now, right now, you're all right, everybody, let's do shoulder rows. 10 forward, here we go. Okay, good, and backwards, 10 backwards. Circles forward, 10 forward, as big as you can. Really think about what you're doing. Once again, feel your body moving through space. As you work, big arm circles forward and backwards. Again, 10 backwards, 3, 4. Good job. Okay, and hands on our hips, bend our knees, and side stretch. 5 on each side. All right, excellent. Now twist our bodies. We'll do 10, 5 on each side. Keep your feet flat on the floor. All right, excellent. Let's do 5 push-ups. Try our best. Here we go. Good, let's do 5 sit-ups. Here we go. Gorgeous day. It's feeling the power of all of us working together right now. Alright, now let's stand up and let's do lunges. Here we go. 3 on each side. Okay, good. And let's do a 10-second plank. Put his knees off the ground. Hold it there for 10. Keep focusing on your breath. Okay, and stand up. Let's do 5 squats. Here we go. 5 best squats ever. Alright, excellent. Good. And let's reach for the sky or the ceiling wherever you are on your toes. Here we go. We're never gonna get there. We're never gonna get to that ceiling. But it's the process. It's the reaching. That's the pure joy. Happiness, joy is in the moment. Nobody can take that away from you. All right, and reach for your toes. Once again, reaching is what matters. It's okay if you don't touch your toes. And come on up, let's grab one leg and balance. Once again, bend that other knee if you have to. Imagine you've got roots growing underneath your feet and pushing or growing into the ground. See that in your mind's eye, where everything is created. All right, and switch, the other one. let's hug our knee. Here we go. Again, find that balance point. Everything you do is all about finding that balance. It's in a stretch. It's in an exercise. It's in a thought, a word. It's everything. All right, good work. And switch. Constantly strive to find our balance, our own unique balance. Among the balance of this universe, the balance of all of us together. Alright, good. And let's sit down. And let's reach for our toes, straight knees. Hold it for 10. Okay, let's do a V-shape with our legs and reach for the floor as far away from your body as you can. And reach for one side. Hold it there. 10 seconds again. And switch to the other side. Feet together and gently push your knees down with your elbows. Hold it there. Okay, one leg forward, one leg back. Keep your knee on the ground. Go as far back as you can without hurting yourself, of course. Lift it for 10. Feel that pull on the front of your bent leg. Switch. I love you, son. I love you, universe. I love you, everyone. Determination. Let's do our best in everything we do. Let's be present right now. Alrighty. And let's do a cobra stretch. Roll onto the floor and push the floor and look up at the ceiling or sky, wherever you are. Feel the awesome power of everything, of you, right here, right now, wherever you are. We are aligning together for the purpose of being our best. Alright, and legs crossed again, back straight, eyes closed. Once again, feel that power of your breathing. That's the true, real, and great you taking control of your breath. Now use that same you, that real you, to be your best. When that music goes on whatever exercise you choose today, we're going to have two songs playing here. I'm going to have two songs. I'm going to visualize myself doing as many sit-ups as I can for one song, and as many lunges, alternating legs, as I can for the other side. I'll start off with sit-ups. How about you? What are you going to visualize right now? Within the space that you have to work with. Keeping in mind the most important thing, your safety. You know how to follow the rules. You know the rules. You're made of the rules of the universe. You're made of truth principles that are designed and there to keep you safe, healthy, and happy, and free, and peaceful. Same way you do your best on these exercises, and that music goes on, it's the same way you'll do everything. Sit-ups for me, what's it gonna be for you? One of my favorite songs, One Love. Love you, Bob Marley, whoever you are. Love you all. We are one love. Here we go. Joy of working on being your best right now. Feel your determination. Feel that energy. That true energy that makes us one and whole and we unify. Wherever you are. Home, wherever you are, we can still do our best. We can still control the power of our determination to grow our minds and to grow our bodies. More importantly, to grow our energy that we are, we were born with that infinite intelligence. Is who we really are. All right, next is lunges for me. See how many I can do with this song. Here we go. What about you? Are you doing jumping jacks? Are you doing push-ups? Are you dancing? Are you freeing your spirit through your body movement in a safe way? Whatever you're doing, do it with determination. Here we go. Might have limits, but our mind and our spirit doesn't. There are no limits. Work on our bodies, we get to work on our spirits, our energy, the greatest power that is in everything and anything. Feel the joy of this moment right now. Wherever you are, we still unite through amazing technology created human beings by infinite intelligence. What makes you infinitely intelligent? No matter what. Never let anything, anyone tell you otherwise. Whatever it takes, you have to know and be who you were born to be. Your best. You're a born winner. Just by being here right now, doing what you're doing. Your energy will never fail. Demonstration of your greatest power
how you can focus on right now. No matter what's going on around you, you can still take control of your breathing. As tired as you might be getting, more proof. But you don't need proof. It's everywhere. I see it everywhere. I feel it everywhere. I feel your energy wherever you are. Thank you. Thank you for all of you. The power of you determining to be grateful right now for this. All right. And we end as we begin. Legs crossed, back straight, eyes closed. Breathing in through our nose and out through our mouth. Well, the truth is, there's no ending, there's no beginning. Today we started, beginning like we always do, with our eyes closed, imagining, going into the future. Only you can do that. Only we can do that. It's all possible through the power of our mind and our thoughts. But we have to control that mind and those thoughts. Even they are not who we really are. To control our minds, to master our minds, we have to simply be here, now, present. That's our super determination. Imagine all of us united with our thoughts, mind and body, as one, all together, right now. That in itself is infinite intelligence. So as we end today, with our eyes closed, our back straight, our legs crossed, we know the truth. We're not really ending. It's never really over. We were all born to win. To be happy, peaceful, loving, kind, caring, mind wealthy, no matter what. That's the truth. The way we do that is now. Right now. They call it present, presence. This is the greatest gift we have, right now. I love you all so much. Have a great day, determination. Have a great week. Remember the truth. Right now is your greatest power. And now just keep doing that. Focus. Right now. I love you all. Have a great day, a great week, and a great life always.
Welcome to the Billionaire Mindset, your 30-day journey to thinking like a billionaire. Now you can just watch this video, or if you want to sign up for the entire series for free and get the bonus PDF companion calendar, check the link in the description below. Today is day 30, and we're gonna learn the must-read books that billionaires say you have to pick up. Enjoy.
Did you surround yourself with mentors? How did you, who did you look to for advice?
I read a lot of books and talked to lots of people. I didn't have any one person who was a mentor, but I always look for feedback from people around me, and feedback from an historical context, you know, which is books basically.
Mm-hmm.
So that's...
Any book stand out as something that was like something that you really relied upon, or?
Well,
are they just general business books, or?
I didn't read actually very many general business books, but I liked biographies and autobiographies. I think those are pretty helpful. So I like, and actually some of them aren't really business, although like somebody like Franklin's, both his autobiography and say the biography that's recently been written by not that recently, but in, I guess 5 or 10 years ago, whenever it was written, the biography by Isaacson, mm-hmm. on Franklin is really good. And you can sort of see how he kind of, because he was an entrepreneur. I mean, he sort of started from nothing. Actually, just like a runaway kid, basically, and created his printing business, and just sort of how he went about doing that, and then over time, he also did science and politics. So that, I would say certainly he's one of the people. I most admire. Like, mm-hmm. Franklin's pretty awesome. But then I think it's also worth reading books on scientists and engineers. Tesla, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Did you hear about that Tesla museum that they're having built?
Yeah,
now?
I actually contributed some funding to save the land.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah,
that was a very cool thing that Oatmeal did.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty cool. I like the way that they put it too. It's like, let's have a goddamn Tesla museum.
Yeah.
I like biographies in general. Biographies, I think, are really, always, you know, really interesting read.
What do you learn from them?
Well, I think you learn a lot, depending upon, you know, whose life you're reading about. There are lots of lessons in there. I read Isaacson's biography of Jobs, which I thought was quite interesting. And I actually really liked his biography of Benjamin Franklin, who I would say is certainly one of my heroes. He seemed like a really great guy.
Basically, I sort of was thinking about this when I was a kid, and trying to find some meaning in life, like what's the meaning of life, you know? I got quite sort of sad about it actually when I was a teenager. And then I read The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy,
mm-hmm.
which basically said like basically the universe is the answer and you just need to figure out the questions. So I think, you know, that's, if I can help kind of figure out the questions, then that I consider that to be meaningful.
I've always liked reading biography, but since the computer's changed my life, I now find myself playing bridge on the computer about 10 hours a week, and unfortunately I didn't want to give up sleep or eating or Berkshire, so the reading has been kind of light. On investment books, if you're asking about that, I would recommend the first two books that Phil Fisher wrote back around 1960, Common Sense and Uncommon Profits, and the second one. Those are very good books. You know, I obviously recommend first and foremost The Intelligent Investor, with chapters 8 and 20 are the ones that you really should read. Two of the, all of the important ideas in investing really are in that book, because there's only about three ideas, and those two of them are emphasized in those two chapters. Actually, I think John Train's Money Masters is an interesting book.
During the shutdown, I had extra time to read. Here are five books that I highly recommend. The Choice by Dr. Edith Eger. It's a hell of a story. The woman was a 16-year-old girl in Auschwitz. She eventually does survive and gets out and moves to Texas and becomes this inspirational therapist. And half the book is her story, half is how she helps other people. when somebody traumatizes you, the way you think about yourself and your happiness and how you relate to the world, you can't control being a victim, but you can control your victimhood. It's kind of a hopeful story, but it's a very tough story. Cloud Atlas by David Mitchell. It's such an unusual book, and it's clever. You go through six different epochs in history where you have people making moral choices, where you see how self-centered and bad people can be and how supportive and good people can be. You really do feel he captures these different worlds. It's a grand story about human nature, enduring human values. The Ride of a Lifetime by Bob Iger. It's hard to overstate how demoralized and messed up Disney was. Things weren't in great shape when they got rid of Eisner. And I do consider it brilliant of Iger.
That in an age where networks are not important and you're going to have to go direct to consumer, that you've got to have a critical mass of the greatest content.
He did a really good job of explaining what the job of the CEO is. The Great Influenza by John Barry. He explains how infections work and how the immune system works. The 1918 Spanish flu is the first world epidemic where it basically hits the entire world. At the same time, the world was faced with this challenge. They tried to come up with drugs or therapeutics. None of those efforts were successful. Distancing and masks and seeing who's coughing, that was all they had. If you read this, you will understand a lot. Good Economics for Hard Times by Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo.
This is the most important book of the group because it really is about what do we know in the field of economics that can take the current divisions and try and do better. It's global, but it's mostly about the U.S. But it's addressing the big issues of the day about people in depressed areas. How can we be so rich and so many people feel a lack of purpose? Why aren't we better with economic knowledge of creating more opportunities? If you want to solve these problems, there's a lot still to learn.
John Brooks is an unbelievable business writer. He's probably my favorite, and it's too bad so many people haven't had a chance to hear about him and the great work he did.
He loved stories with vivid characters. Venal, bumbling, brilliant, you name it, he loved them.
He was a novelist at heart, and he found a lot of good stories in Wall Street.
Warren Buffett gave me a copy of Business Adventure, feeling like with our dialogue about trying to understand the world of business, that I'd enjoy it as much as he had. And in fact, it was phenomenal.
Oh, I knew he'd like it. I mean, that was written for him. It was written for me, too. If you're going to run a company, you should read The Impact of Philosophers. I mean, when you learn how really probably pretty decent people start behaving in bad ways, that's fascinating.
He talks about these people in GE who would wink when they would actually say what the rule book said to do. Now remember, you cannot talk to our competitors about this wink, you know, which is essentially saying, go talk to them.
But he makes it come alive in a particular way. He makes it come alive as comedy because he understands that most of the time, if you look closely enough, the motives of the people involved are as short-sighted and self-seeking as all other human motives, and that's the material of comedy.
Ford Motor Company was super successful. They introduced a car called the Edsel, and they spent more money on picking the name and planning the features than had ever been spent on any new American product. And yet, it was an abysmal failure.
Ford counted on selling at least 200,000 Edsels the first year. There may be an aborigine somewhere in a remote rainforest who hasn't yet heard that things failed to turn out that way. I just love that line.
And yet, in a way, the Edsel wasn't so bad. It embodied much of the spirit of its time, or at least of the time when it was designed, early in 1955. It was clumsy, powerful, dowdy, gauche, well-meaning, a de Kooning woman.
I think you can read this book today and learn a lot.
All the work of Michael Lewis comes directly from Brooks.
I mean, he really was the Michael Lewis of his day.
The rules of running a great business, value creation, are unchanged. And Brooks took some very dramatic examples that are particularly fun and interesting and instructive.
I started Bridgewater out of a two-bedroom apartment in 1975. And I've brought it to where it is now. According to Fortune, it's the fifth most important private company in the United States. It's been successful, it's been good. And that my objective at this particular stage is to help others be successful without me. I learned along the way certain principles. Every time I would make a decision, I would write down the reasons I would make that decision. And I put them out, I debated them, and I developed these principles. So think about principles as just being these reasons for making a decision. If you're in this situation, how do you deal with it? It was also very important to me to operate in a very unusual way that seemed very sensible to me, and it's an idea meritocratic way. So I want to describe Bridgewater as being an idea meritocracy. In other words, a real idea meritocracy, which I'll explain and show to you. So a real idea meritocracy in which the goals are meaningful work and meaningful relationships. Meaningful work, I mean you're on a mission, that you feel you're on a mission together to do those great things. And meaningful relationships, meaning that you care about each other, it's part of a community, and to be on that mission together. And that was really good, great in terms of our success, but it was meaningful work and meaningful relationships through radical truthfulness and radical transparency. That means literally people saying anything that they feel that they want to say, in terms of being polite, of course, but sharing what they really believe is true and working themselves through to have an idea meritocratic way, and to literally record everything for everybody to hear. So I mean literally, there are a combination of videos and tapes of all meetings that happen so that nothing is hidden. Because you can't have a real idea meritocracy if you can't see things yourself. And so it's a very unusual place, and it was really the basis of our success. And I want to explain that way of operating to you, because this idea meritocratic way in which there's meaningful work and meaningful relationships through radical truthfulness and radical transparency, so that you could have thoughtful disagreement and have ways of getting past that disagreement to then move on, like a legal system, that has been the key to our success. So that's what I want to try to convey to you. And I'm just going to take a few minutes to try to go through a few slides to give you a sense of this. You know, I wanted big audacious goals. I wish big audacious goals for you. Go after your goals, and on your way to your goals, you're going to encounter your problems and your failures, right? That's going to happen. Otherwise, you just go straight to your goals. No, that's the learning process. You encounter your failures. Failures is part of the learning process. From the failures, what I found was great is I started to think of failures as lessons. I started to think of them as puzzles rather than develop emotional reactions to those failures. I started to think pain plus quality reflection would give me progress. So I started to think of failures like puzzles, that if I could study the puzzles was, what would I do differently in the future that wouldn't produce that problem again when it happened? So, and then I would reflect, well, what was that would be my principles. What would I do differently in the future? If I solved that puzzle, I would get a gem. And the gem was a principle to handle it better in the future. Because failure is a learning process. It's an essential part of the learning process. If you can realize that and you write down those principles, write them down, it's been fantastic. So we learn those principles, and then it would help me improve, and then I would go on to more audacious goals. And I look at evolution, personal evolution, or almost every evolution, evolution of a company, evolution of everything, as being this constant looping process that I sort of think of as this five-step process, right? In other words, to be successful, you have to do five things. You have to know what your goals are and go after those goals. Be clear on your goals. and you will encounter problems on the way to those goals. Those will be your barriers, okay? They're your tests now. Don't just emotionally complain. Think about them as your problems. You have to diagnose those problems to the root cause, to get at the root cause. And that root cause might be yourself, what you're doing wrong, or what somebody else is doing wrong. So you can't depersonalize it. You have to really look at it so that you make those changes. And when you get at that root cause, only by knowing that root cause, can then you design a way to get around that root cause. Like if you're not good at something yourself, it's okay if you find somebody else who's good at the things that you're not good at, because nobody can be good at everything, right? So, but you have to do that. You just can't keep banging yourself in the wall. So you have to design something that's practical to get around with it, and then you have to follow through and do it. A lot of people come up with designs, but you have to do the thing that's necessary. And by trying that thing that's necessary, again, you will find out, are you getting to your goals, or you'll cop, or you encounter your next set of problems, and so on. And that, I believe, is the first personal evolutionary process that has helped me. Those rules that I was able to write down, and that you can get in these this book, Principles, which is why I'm passing them along, those rules, we were actually able to then to put into algorithms and build decision-making processes that replicate the brain. We'll get into that in a minute. Okay, so in order to be successful in the markets, one has to be an independent thinker. In order to be an entrepreneur, one has to be an independent thinker and bet against the consensus and be right. Because the consensus in the markets is built into the price. Whatever anybody thinks, that's built into the price. So you have to think, you have to bet against the consensus. And you're going to be wrong a fair amount of times about betting against the consensus. But in any case, you need to be an independent thinker. And for an entrepreneur, you need to be an independent thinker, because you're inventing new stuff, you're doing something, and you don't know if you're right. So in order for me to be successful, I needed to have a bunch of independent thinkers in order to have them be effective. Okay, well, now how are you going to get this bunch of independent thinkers to agree on anything? Okay, I had to have an idea meritocracy. In other words, I had to have a system that literally systematically allows for thoughtful disagreement so that these idea meritocratic people could then get at the right answer, because that's fantastic. If you can have that thoughtful disagreement to get at the right answer, it's very powerful. By having that and then systemizing it, principled systems, a system for having thoughtful disagreement, for an idea meritocracy, we could produce greater amounts of successes. We also produced failures, but we would look at that way, produce our learnings, and that would produce, as a result, happy employees who really believe in this idea meritocratic thing and own the company intellectually and otherwise, own the company. And we had happy employees. And then it became easier to attract those types of people who believe that, you know, everybody has the right to make sense of things and that there's a power in thoughtful disagreement. And that allowed us to attract more people. And that was the basis of going from the 2-bedroom apartment to Bridgewater now.
At Walmart, we have back to campus in the bag. Get electronics, dorm room essentials, fall fashion, and stationery all at low prices. Shop in-store or online and get free shipping on orders over $35. Restrictions apply. See walmart.ca for details.
In 2012, I did a Business Week cover story on Elon. And, you know, we got along pretty well. I got to spend a bunch of time with him going through the SpaceX factory. We went to movie premieres and all this stuff. And you know, the companies were very interesting. And Elon was much more interesting than I'd given him credit for before the story. He, you know, I'd sort of pegged him as just like a one-note techno-utopian kind of guy. And, you know, he turned out to be this great interview. He didn't have PR handlers around him, so you had access to him, and he would answer just about anything you asked him. And so I decided then, this is a guy I really want to write about, and I'd been looking for a book to do. And so after I did the story, a couple months went by, and then I started to feel Elon out about doing a book. And I think I either sent him an email or called him on the phone, and I said, this is what I want to do. And he said, look, a bunch of people have asked me in the past, and I'm not gonna do it. I'm not gonna help you do the book. And then I went to New York and sold the book anyway. And I thought I would sort of force his hand a little bit. And then I arranged another meeting with him. And I'll never forget, it was on a Saturday at Tesla. And I came in, I was like, look, I've sold the book. And he said, I'm still not gonna cooperate with you. And so I spent like 18 months interviewing hundreds of people. I found like all these SpaceX and Tesla employees, most of whom had left, all the Zip2, PayPal people that he'd worked with, his ex-girlfriends, his like childhood friends and all that stuff. And then, you know, a lot of those people would call back to Elon and say, should I speak to him or not? And he was a pretty good sport about it. There's nobody that he told not to. And so I think that happened enough times that after about 18 months of doing it, I was at home. It's like 6:30 at night on a weekday, and up on my caller ID, it was just Elon Musk. And I picked up the phone, and he said, look, I can basically, this is gonna go one of two ways. I can shut down all these people that call me and ask whether, you know, I should let them talk to you, or I could cooperate with the book. And I was like, obviously, you should choose option number B, or option B. And then we set up a meeting to talk about it. He wanted to have some control over it initially. He wanted to be able to read the book before it came out, and then he wanted to put footnotes in the book. And if you like know anything about Elon, that would mean, you know, the footnotes would be longer than the book, and that the book would probably never be published. And sure. So I kind of pushed back on him on that. I had this huge speech prepared, and I got like 5 minutes into it, and he just said, okay. And
wow.
To his credit. After that, he gave me access to everybody I wanted, and then he agreed to have a meeting with me, you know, once a month, he said, for as long as it took. It ended up being about 8 months, and we would have like 3, 4, 5 hour dinners.
What is it like to spend a few hours a month interviewing Elon Musk?
It was really fun. At the beginning, it was nerve-wracking because I never knew how many of these interviews I would actually get, even though he had agreed to it. I always figured, sort of thought, you know, he might do one and then he'd be like, okay, that's enough. And then I thought, you know, he might get sick of it after a while and just cut me off.
Sure.
So each one, it was sort of like, felt like an accomplishment. But then it was frustrating because the first four, I was getting lots of useful stuff, but nothing that was, I could tell he was still holding back a bit, and he was repeating a lot of stories that, if you kind of watch Elon's speeches and other talks that you would have heard before.
Sure.
And so that was frustrating. And then I'm still not sure exactly what happened, but around the fourth meeting, you know, we used to always do the same thing. We would get there, he eats really late, so it'd be like 8:30, 9 o'clock at night, and we would go a few times till just everybody had left. And it was kind of one of those things. There was like hardly anybody there. And he just, it was like a switch kind of flipped. I think he'd sort of really committed to doing it, and he became much more relaxed and easygoing.